Since the crisis began, there's been a lot of political turmoil in Greece, to the degree where this is the third government. The first one was toppled by a combination of huge amounts of public pressure. This government could not actually survive. And then the second one after that was instituted by the creditors. So the creditors had put in place a banker to carry out their demand. And then afterwards, again from a huge amount of public pressure, they were forced to have elections, which didn't yield a government. They had to have elections again. That is a huge amount of political turmoil. And of course the balances that change in that indicate big changes in society. So in terms of what the government is doing, in each of these cases, we've had governments that are basically carrying out the demands of the creditors. The creditors being a combination of the Troika, which are the people, which are this sort of institutional arrangement providing the bailouts. It's not just the Troika demands, it's the market demands, it's the dictatorship of the markets. What the Greek government is doing in alliance with these bodies is implementing a series of very radical reforms, structural adjustment policies, as they used to be called, now they're called memoranda. And in those are very detailed action plans, because they're not legal documents, they're action plans, which outline very, very detailed reforms that Greek government has to take. So they touch on all the classic structural adjustment type reforms. It's sometimes called the unholy trinity of privatization, deregulation and liberalization. Greece has to do certain things to receive money. And those sorts of things are cutting the wage bill. I mean, it varies a lot from sector to sector, but in total, probably about 30% real income decrease because of structural adjustment reforms. Same with pensions. People have been contributing pensions their whole life to get a pension, but actually they've been slashed and now they're getting a lot less. There's a huge amount of labour market reform. The thing that we call labour rights, people have a right to a decent way of working and to actually being protected against their employer from firing them whenever they want, from giving them compensation fee, from having decent labour conditions against, you know, the power which is your employer. All of those are being scrapped to the extent that it's like an, you know, it's like returning 200 years back in terms of rights. Rights are being totally ripped up. I mean, privatisation is the next main one where all of the state's assets, all of the public utility companies, rights to land that the government owns, which would include mining rights and all of these kinds of things, have been transferred to a privatisation fund, which is being managed by the creditors. And they think they can sell everything that Greece owns to pay back a debt, which the Greek people don't actually owe. One in two people are unemployed for young people. That means that when you lose your job, you're not going to find one, basically. And it's interesting to compare it to here, because here friends get unemployed and they're unemployed for a few weeks and they get really depressed. Or they suddenly feel really bad that they're going to go on the dole. And actually in Greece, when you don't have a job, you know now that you're actually not going to find one unless you move country. And that's the reality for most people. And that's extremely depressing. And it's also extremely depressing that most of the unemployed people are not actually on the dole, because there isn't enough dole money and the dole money is actually going down. People rely on all sorts of other things, including basically mass destitution. So the amount of people actually living on the streets now is a lot higher than they used to be. You never used to see that destitution in Greece. People relying on other people is going through the roof. But, you know, that varies from the informal support networks to looking into the rubbish for everything that you need. It's having a huge impact on mental health, on people's stress levels, on people on antidepressants. People are in a situation where the amount they were earning each month has dropped drastically. The amount they have to pay in tax has increased dramatically. You know, taxes are being applied retrospectively. I mean, things are, which is totally, totally legal. You can't charge someone 6 months before for a tax. There's a lot of depressing stories because the situation is very depressing. But again, the severity of the crisis has called for severe action. And people are taking severe action because, you know, it's a kind of when push comes to shove situation. And a lot of those things that have come up now are really, really promising for actually the sort of economy that we want. And a lot of those principles that are based on that, which are based on solidarity or based on cooperation and that kind of mutualistic exchange. And a lot of them are actually fightbacks, people refusing to actually accept the measures that are being passed. One of the main ones was for one of these tax hikes, which was being implemented through the electricity bill. people en masse in their neighbourhoods would say, we're not going to pay this tax hike for the electricity bill. So people were organising on a local level to make sure that, you know, if the electricity company comes and cuts the electricity line, people will be there to support them. And this won't be isolated examples of like victimisation. Of course, the union in the electricity company had actually fought and said, we're not going to cut anyone's electricity. People occupying offices, spontaneous organising, people are not going to wait for the union to make a decision. People are going to sort of organise and take some action. And I guess in some way shut those things down to make sure that people actually, you know, their voices are heard, basically. Some other really promising things in that regard are a lot of long-term strikes that have gone on, places where the employers were bankrupt and couldn't keep running really big companies that employed a lot of people. The workers have taken on those factories. A lot of solidarity has gone on from lots of different social struggles to support those strikers. This included a public hospital where the nurses hadn't been paid for more than a year and they took over the running of the public hospital. A lot of action has been taken by doctors in public hospitals where now that people, although you've been paying social security contribution, you're now being forced to pay for healthcare. Doctors refusing that fee. So actually, if people can't afford it, the doctors are not implementing the law that's been passed, accepting people who can't pay. There's a lot of new types of organisation happening, people forming cooperatives, people forming self-help networks, self-run health clinics. Basically, a lot of things in response to the fact that the social sector is being robbed and disintegrating. So a lot of these self-run clinics are run by professional doctors in their free time, and they're extremely busy because people can't afford to go to private doctors or the state waiting list, or they're not going to get seen. So there is people are really in a lot of ways actually coming together in that, or at least people are fighting their own battles in their own ways, and that is creating this very kind of creating this dynamic sort of fight back. People aren't going to take it, basically. It's a kind of a battle between optimism and pessimism, because history's in the making, that political battles are being fought all the time on the street between the fascists and everybody else, in the workplace. It's a really fluid situation. That's what a crisis is, basically. A crisis is a very fluid, up for grabs, free-fall, in which the winners and the losers haven't yet been concluded. You started by asking, what is the crisis in Greece, and is it a debt crisis? The thing is that at the moment, it has been transformed into a debt crisis. The framework is a blackmail of, you need to do these measures, which are having all of these bad effects, to receive money to pay back the creditors. None of that money is going in the economy. The thing that we have to frame the debate is that actually there are ways to stop paying the creditors. We don't actually have to pay back the debt because this debt is illegitimate. And there's a lot of work to be done to actually lay the ground to convince people, because the propaganda machine of the media has done a very good job in convincing people they need to repay the debt. But actually they don't. And there have been cases in the past when debts aren't repaid. And Greece with 200% of debt to GDP isn't going to go anywhere. And we can implement reforms, we can fire everybody who works in this public sector, but the debt's still going to be there. We have to address the debt issue. And that involves, you know, well, just having a big write-down, basically, and not asking for anything in return. Yeah, that's it.